George Akel. Welcome back to the Govern HR YouTube channel. Last video, we showed you the taxonomy-based risk identification, the framework there for that methodology. And if you recall, it was a hierarchical structure where you went from the highest level down to the branches and sub-branches and leaves down here below. Now, I've received a few requests for people who have asked to get a demonstration from an HR perspective how this would work. We were going to do that. We were going through all the life cycle, employment life cycle. So I thought we'd kick off with the hiring process and we'd do that early to give everybody an overview. So we start off with the highest level, level one, and it's employment practices. The overall umbrella that covers the employment practices end to end, the employee life cycle, for want of a better word there. Level two here, we're looking at the hiring process. That's the branch there off the trunk. And then we're looking at the level three. Remember, we level three was the activity risk examples, and we're talking here about the hiring process. Now let's go through some of these. And for this example, we're going to go through the risk process, the risk examples, and we'll look at the mitigation strategy later and the owners, etc. And we'll put up a comprehensive matrix for you, and you can utilize that in your own organization. The first one is hiring staff that don't meet the organization's standards. Now that's very straightforward: integrity, culture, values, and regulatory standards. So some organizations operating in the financial services or insurance have strict requirements to hire people fit and proper or qualified for advising clients or advising the general public on investment, etc. Hiring staff at the wrong pay grade or the hierarchical level, now again, it creates a problem within your organization because it puts things out of kilter. You've got an organizational structure there within a business. You've already got a partner or a director, whatever your hierarchy stipulates, whatever the naming convention that you utilize, and then you hire another partner or another director, and you've got a top-heavy organization. You need to think it through. You need to be able to understand not just what you're doing now, but the future as well. And also with the pay rates, you don't want to be creating a problem for yourself down the track when you're going through a compensation process down the track. Now, it's not to say we should underpay people. If the individual is that's the right pay, that's the right grade, then we need to relook at our own organization maybe. Now, hiring not vetted by HR, now that pretty much covers a lot of the areas here, but HR should be involved in every step of the way. They should be aware, they should be guiding, they should be managing the process, you know, the business partner, right? Partner in the business. And there's nothing more critical than the hiring of individuals. You're the gatekeeper bringing people in. Hiring for unapproved positions or roles. Now, a good discipline to have is to have targets and budgets, not just financial, but also from a headcount and FTE perspective. So it's important that people are disciplined and only hire for open positions, for approved roles. They look internally to see if there's someone internally that can fill these roles before they go externally. So that's critical there. Hiring related parties. Now you only have to Google Princelings to see the damage that hiring related parties has done to a lot of organizations, with hundreds of millions of dollars in penalties, reputations tarnished, image destroyed, etc., etc. So there's got to be steps in place there to mitigate that risk. Hiring staff with the wrong skills for the role. Now you may have a management role that you're wanting to fill in a pharmaceutical organization. So individual needs to manage 20 or 30 people in a lab, etc., or someone's got to manage a team on a trading desk. So you need to look at someone with skills in that area, not just skills in pharmaceutical or skills in trading. They need to have the skills in managing people, because you put the wrong person in there, you're going to have a problem. Utilizing unproved recruitment vendors. Now this happens from time to time because there's a friendship that builds up between the business and another recruiter, or the HR business partner and another recruiter, etc. Generally speaking, if you've got good discipline, good HR structure, good HR governance, you've struck up a deal with several or one recruitment vendor that you can trust to deliver on high quality talent and high quality candidates, and you also get a good discount with the process there. Now, hiring someone through an unapproved one would cause a rift with your existing vendor, and it would also cost you more because it doesn't apply the discount that you've negotiated. Hiring unqualified or underqualified staff now, whether you're hiring for accounting or legal or medical, etc., you need to ensure that people have the proper qualifications to meet the requirements of the role. Poor time to market, that is, unable to hire at the volumes or the speed your organization need. Now, we're all living today in this COVID-19 period where a lot of organizations have trimmed down, stopped operating, put staff off, etc. So once things turn around, in certain areas there'll be a huge competition for talent in the market, and it'll be requirement for high-performing talent, good talent, and to hire them at speed. So is your organization capable of doing that? Is your recruitment group, either internal or external, able to do that? That's important for an organization. Rehiring former employees that have been previously terminated for cause or poor performers generally occurs for organizations that have got multiple geographical footprints. So someone in the US has been working for you, has been terminated for fraud or some other misdemeanor, or is just being a poor performer, packs up their bags and move to Singapore, and unbeknownst to the people in Singapore, you know, they hire the individual who's worked at your organization previously, don't check up on that, and you end up with a problem. You've terminated someone there and you've hired them here. It's important. Now, what we're going to do in the future, we're going to give you risk mitigation for all of these, what the controls that should be in place, who in the organization should own these risks and be responsible for the controls, and also talk about how these hand off with other aspects of the employee life cycle. Now, at GovernHR, we've not just put these templates together, we've not just conducted reviews of the risk within every aspect of HR across an entire HR platform, but we've also worked in here. We've conducted recruitment, we've been business partners, we've conducted vendor reviews, we've managed to build targets for future hiring, open positions, pipelines, etc. So please click the like button. If you like this video, subscribe to our channel so you get the latest videos up front. And please do check our website. If you've got any questions, drop us a line or make a comment below in the YouTube comment area or on LinkedIn, and we'll be able to address it. We're happy to answer questions if you have them. So thank you very much. All the best, and stay safe. Thank you.